All right, the next thing I want to talk about is bearings. So we've already looked at this planetary gear set in a previous video. And what you need to know about bearings, well, there's several things, but one is that in between each set of rotating pieces, there is at least one bearing. And those bearings have an up and a down, and they need to be installed properly or the bearings can be destroyed. And so I want to show you how to tell which way a bearing should be oriented. Okay, I have the input shaft out of our Allison 1000 transmission, and the input shaft has a bearing that fits right there. And that bearing can be installed properly just like it is, or it can be flipped around backwards, and that will cause bearing damage and eventual transmission damage. Now, what's the difference? Well, let's take a little closer look at the bearing itself. First, if you notice, this surface right here wraps around and connects to this surface. It's all one piece. That's the outer bearing race of this bearing. And then notice the inner race has this surface and it wraps around and goes down inside the middle. So we have an inner race and an outer race. This outer race with that 90 degree angle turn right there of the same part needs to go in and match the 90 degree angle turn in the housing that it goes in. So this 90 degree angle matches that 90 degree angle and it just fits in there like that. If we turn it over, there's a couple of problems here. One, the outer race right here rotates at a different speed and even a different direction than the inner race. And so if that outer race is fitting in, or fits in this groove, and the inner race fits on this flat spot here, you're making this bearing spin inside of the metal-to-metal contact housing, which we never want the bearing to spin in a metal-to-metal contact housing there, and it can burn itself up rotating inside of the metal housing that it's supposed to sit in. So if I turn that over, notice now the inner race rotates, but the outer race stays with the housing that it fits in. So that's one way to look at it, is try to determine what's the rotational speed, what are the angles of the different pieces of the bearing race versus the housing that it goes in. But even a bigger tell is if you look at the back side of this bearing race, I want you to see that we have material that is sticking up right here. This is not flat. And if we put this in backwards like this, and we're expecting this bearing surface to sit on something flat, this part sticking up from the inner race on the other side will interfere with the bearing's ability to sit against something flat. And it ends up pushing the bearing through, bending it, and will end up breaking it. So these little bearings, it's very critical that you put them in correctly. If you put this one in upside down and we had that additional lip sticking up there, it also affects the overall clearances inside the transmission. It lifts this entire input shaft up, however much of a distance that lip is in there, and it throws off your measurements because there's supposed to be an input shaft in play check and an output shaft in play measurement or check on most transmissions. So bearings are very critical that they get put in the proper orientation. My best suggestion to you is to pay attention to what I just showed you there, but even more importantly, if you can find it, look in the service manual, the service information, electronic service information, and find a diagram that shows you which way those bearings go. So for example, over here on the wall, I've had this poster sitting here all semester of the Allison transmission. And this is a cutaway view of the Allison transmission. But it also shows that exact same bearing that we just looked at. So if I zoom in on that bearing, right there, right where the yellow meets the blue, you can see that little bearing. And if you look at the inner race, it's got that part that juts down and goes towards the left of the screen, and the outer race with its 90 degree angle turn. You can try to look at the bearing itself and look at the cutaway view to see which way it's supposed to go in. And this shows all of the bearings inside of this transmission. And then there's other diagrams that will give you even a better view inside the transmission, depending on the year, make, model of the transmission and the service information that you're looking at. Okay, the next thing I want to talk about are seals. The seals that help the hydraulic fluid stay in the passages and in the pistons where it's supposed to go. So this is a clutch piston and return springs, as we've talked about. This particular one is out of the Allison transmission. That's why it's so huge. But because it's large, it works out well for looking at two different types of seals. So this is the bottom of the piston. There's a seal, this black rubber piece right here, as you can see on the inside. There's another seal around the outside. Hydraulic fluid, pressurized fluid, comes below this, or towards the back of the vehicle. It's facing like this. Oh, I've got that backwards. This is the back of the vehicle on the right here. And as the pressure comes in, it moves towards the front of the vehicle, applying the C5 clutch pack. Well, in order for that piston to move, these seals have to be in good shape. So there's two different types of seals on this piston. This inner seal right here is actually a lip seal, which means it's only going to seal in one direction. It's like the seal that you see in a master cylinder. It's got a lip here on the edge of it. And if you notice, it has a nice sharp edge going around the outside of it there. And this seal, if we were to take it out and put it in upside down, let's take it out here. If we put that in upside down, the lip would be facing down as far as this piston is concerned, and the fluid would just push right past that lip seal, because lip seals only seal in one direction. And so you've got to make sure that when you are replacing a seal, especially a lip seal like this one, that you understand which way it's supposed to point. And one of the easiest ways to determine that is to see which way that piston has to move. But when in doubt, you can always go to the cutaway view, as we've looked at on the wall there, to see, or in the service information, as we've talked about, to see which way it goes. Okay, so these seals, you should run your finger along them, checking for nicks or damage. If you're going to all the trouble of taking the transmission apart, you should replace these seals anyway. But these seals over time will harden up. This rubber will get very hard and it won't seal anymore. I've even seen chunks break out of them. And then of course the whole piston won't move because fluid just rushes past the broken portion of the seal. All right, so we have a lip seal on the inside. Oh, by the way, you lubricate everything inside the transmission with the same transmission fluid that you are going to use inside of the transmission, the factory recommended fluid. There is an assembly lube called Transgel that can be used in certain instances to kind of help glue something in place while you assemble it. But overall, the best lubrication for everything, bearing seals, gears, everything, is the actual fluid that you're going to use. All right, now this other seal right here on the outside, this is not a lip seal, which means it'll seal in both directions. And to replace that seal, you might think that you'd have to get a pick of some sort to get in there and pull that seal out. But if you just come in with your thumb on each side of that seal and give it a good push, you can see that you can just push it right out. And then pull it out and around. This seal, sometimes referred to as a D-ring, if you were to cut it in half, it would look like the letter D, except squished down pretty far. This outer edge here can be rounded on some. It can be square on some. You want to make sure that you, like on any seal, that you're very careful putting it back in. Don't stretch it very much at all to get it back in the groove where it goes. And make sure it's lubricated as it should be. And make sure that it doesn't get twisted as you put it in. So that seal I've got back in as if it were new. And then our lip seal, just going to tuck it back into the groove where it goes, just like that. All right, so a lip seal, a D-shaped seal, or a rectangular shape, square cut type of seal. You'll see these throughout automatic transmissions on pistons. Another type of piston and seal assembly is where the piston, this piece right here, and two lip seals, there's an inner seal right here and an outer seal right here. If we look real close there, the seals are part of the piston. They're formed in place on the piston. So if you have a seal go bad, you replace the entire piston itself. Some pistons have a little bleed hole in them. Can you see that hole right there? That typically is oriented at a certain position in the transmission, typically the 12 o'clock position or straight up position. And the purpose of that is to allow air to bleed out as fluid comes in if this piston is a piston that does not rotate. This particular piston does not rotate, it just moves forward and backwards in the case of the Allison. But there are other pistons that will rotate, and they may have some sort of a bleed hole, or even some have a check ball. The check ball will seat while there's fluid pressure there and unseat when there is no pressure there. So pay attention to the instructions once again in the service information. All right, let's take a look at some other seals. So here on this input shaft of the Allison transmission, we have some seals that keep fluid in between these two grooves here, going into this hole right here, which actually can come out the top of the shaft here. But we have these seals that have a nice flat end on them, a square cut seal. Notice it's just kind of a rectangular shape in a round seal. These are very brittle. As you put them on the shaft, you need to just only stretch them out just far enough to get it back on. Notice that there are two seals on this shaft. You could have three, four, five seals depending on the transmission design. And then when it's put back in, make sure it's good and lubricated, and the ends are flush with each other. Some of them have overlapping ends to where they need to go under each other. Make sure that it looks right and follow the instructions when you put those together. Let's look at the back of this 10-speed transmission here. The output shaft of this 10-speed has two seals also. Those seals are overlapping, just like I was talking about a little bit earlier. So they spread out and are removed also. There's another type of seal where the entire seal is a single piece and it does not spread open to come out. And instead you have to stretch them to get them off. And then there's new ones that you put on that there are special service tools to stretch them out and then drop them down into the groove. And then there are other tools called sizers that will squish the seal back down into the proper size that it's supposed to be. So those are one piece full circle seals where these open up and can be removed quite easily and reinstalled without an installer and a sizer being involved. All right, down here on the front cover, here's another one of those great big seals that you can just use two fingers and squish the seal together enough to pull it out. Here on this oil pan of this 10-speed, there's an aluminum gasket between the pan and the housing. Sometimes those gaskets are reusable, other times they are not. You'll have to look at the service information and see. Over here on this Allison transmission, it has a reusable rubber gasket with a metal insert inside of it. Sometimes reusable, sometimes not. You got to pay attention to the service information for that. Well, those are some pretty common seals. There may be other types of seals that you'll run into, but the main idea is to keep them, or to inspect them, make sure there's no nicks and that they are still flexible, and then get them lubricated, install them without stretching them too much and without twisting or damaging them.